welcome to the Chapter 7.8 overview, Mass Atrocities. Our essential question asks about the causes and consequences of mass atrocities from 1900 to the present. So this is a causation question, and we'll be looking at causes and effects of atrocities. In our unit map, we will see that the events of World War I and World War II were the central causes of these mass atrocities, which ends our unit. A relevant historical pattern, of course, is that as states tend to expand and consolidate, there is sometimes ethnic or religious conflict. This map here shows an example of conflict between Muslims and Christians, especially along the border here of the Caliphate in Spain. And this map here would be an example of ethnic conflict. The Ottoman Empire was largely Turk, and there were some conflicts within the empire with other ethnic groups, such as Arabs, for instance. But these conflicts did not reach the level that we will see in this section of atrocities. For our context, one of the things that made these atrocities possible were advances in military technology, and of course the rise of totalitarian governments and the role of international peacekeeping organizations. So we start with talking about the military technology, giving examples of totalitarian rulers like Stalin and Hitler, and the fact that they often used extreme solutions to problems. And we introduce organizations like the League of Nations and United Nations, and how successful they were is a determining factor in the severity of human rights abuses. And that's the connection here to the prompt. So we'll be looking at several examples of atrocities in the 20th century. And first, just a reminder about the immense death toll of World War I, both military and civilian. And one of the events during World War I was our first genocide. And the definition of genocide here is the deliberate killing of a large group of people, especially those of a particular ethnic group or nation. So it tends to be targeted mass killing with the desire to eliminate as many members of a particular group as possible. Within the Ottoman Empire, between 500,000 and 1.5 million ethnic Armenians were killed by Turk forces in camps or executed outright. To this day, the government of Turkey claims that these were reasonable wartime casualties, but most observers would call this history's first genocide. And here's a picture of an Armenian genocide memorial. We have talked about famine in the Ukraine before. It was the legacy of a poorly managed agricultural policy from Stalin's five-year plan. He set quotas for how much food had to be produced. They were very unreasonable, and in some cases, peasants hid food, because if they delivered everything they were supposed to, they would starve, and people were sent to camps called the Gulag, or executed for that. And Stalin, even though the policy was failing, refused to change it because it would show weakness, he thought. And we estimate that as many as 7 to 10 million people died in this famine. The most infamous of these atrocities is the Holocaust in Nazi Germany. Remember that Hitler ruled with totalitarian power, and a lot of the victims of the Holocaust were political prisoners who were seen as a threat to his rule. So here's this percentage, estimated about 10% of the people who died were political prisoners. We know that Hitler had a racist ideology, that he tried to create a society in which what he perceived as the master race was supreme. And so there were members of other ethnic groups, such as Roma, also known as Gypsies, such as ethnic Poles and Ukrainians and Belarusians. And then, of course, Hitler's anti-Semitism made Jewish people the largest single target of the Holocaust. The persecution of Jews happened in stages. At first, their freedoms were taken away with policies like the Nuremberg Laws. Then Jews were forced to live in neighborhoods called ghettos. Then they were imprisoned in concentration camps. And starting about 1942, was implementing something called the Final Solution, and these are the death camps. And Auschwitz, for instance, which is the most infamous, was in Poland, which is why we have such a large percentage of Polish Jews on this graph. We estimate that 6 million Jews were killed and 5 million or more other groups. During the Japanese invasion of China, the Rape of Nanking resulted in an estimated 100,000 or more Chinese people killed, many of them civilians. There were also more deaths from forced labor after the invasion, as many as 1 million people. Next, we look at the Allies during World War II, and there were some mass deaths caused by the strategy of firebombing. The city of Hamburg, in which an estimated 50,000 people killed, and Dresden, both in Germany, and then Tokyo, resulted in significant civilian deaths. And then, of course, the atomic bomb attacks on Hiroshima with an estimated 200,000 deaths. The cause of this was a goal to reduce the number of deaths overall by speeding up the end of the war. Despite the goal of many organizations after World War II to prevent something like the Holocaust from happening again, we do have three post-World War II examples of genocide. The country of Yugoslavia was created after World War II, and it was a multi-ethnic communist dictatorship, and when it fell apart in the 90s after the collapse of the Soviet Union, there were ethnic cleansing against Bosnian Muslims by Serb forces, and we estimate that over 300,000 people were killed. When Belgian colonizers ruled Rwanda, they had given a minority group called the Tutsi more power than the majority Hutu. After their independence, conflict broke out between those two groups, and the Hutu, largely in retaliation, initiated a genocide against Tutsis, and we estimate that over 1 million people were killed. And in the Sudan, more recently, a government militia in a region called Darfur began targeting non-Arabs, and we estimate that 200,000 people were killed. And one of the things that these genocides share is an ineffective global response, that there were organizations like the African Union or the United Nations that were expected to prevent such ethnic cleansing from happening, and they failed. And it's important for us to think about these deaths and how we decide if they are military necessity or genocide. And who is it who makes that decision? Is it a government? Is it public opinion at large? Is it human rights organizations like Amnesty International? Is it international organizations like the United Nations? We do have documents such as the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which defines the rights of individuals. The United Nations has passed resolutions defining genocide. But these kinds of debates continue. When you look at the Armenian genocide in the Ottoman Empire, recently the U.S. Congress passed a resolution condemning those events as a genocide. The government of Turkey to this day denies that it is a genocide. The Holocaust is universally regarded as a genocide. Here in the United States, we do not consider the atomic bomb attacks to be genocide. There may be people in other countries who do. And so it's important for us to work together to look at our past, define these terms, and do what we can to prevent events like this from happening again. Our timeline lists those main examples of genocide and mass death: Armenia, Ukraine, the Holocaust, Rape of Nanking, atomic bombs, Bosnia, Rwanda, and Darfur. And looking at the causes and consequences of these atrocities, the general causes of mass atrocities are any number of these examples: ethnic conflict, religious conflict, a lack of effective international response. Our book starts with a quote from Hitler, who in 1939 dismissed concerns that there would be retaliation against the Germans by saying, "Who speaks today of the annihilation of the Armenians?" The belief, either right or wrong, that these atrocities are a necessary military strategy, and political conflict, such as the way totalitarian leaders treated their enemies. Consequences, of course, primarily are a devastating death toll. We also have a lack of freedom that results, and in many cases, the perpetuating discrimination and stereotypes against ethnic or religious groups who are different from the leaders. That's your Chapter 7.8 overview. Happy studying.